He's worthy of your adoration. And I'm so thankful that I'm able to be in the house of the Lord with you this evening and lift praises to our King. Church, I love worship songs that are pulled directly from the Word. We can sing it and we can come together. We can have a great time of worship. But listen to these words in Revelation chapter 4. The 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. Church, it is the word that you proclaim when you tell the Lord Jesus that He's worthy of your praise, when you lift that voice of praise, and I'm so thankful for it this evening. Church, you may be seated. We have a few special announcements for you this evening, but before we get into our regular list of announcements, I would like to ask Brother Matthew Cunningham to make his way to the pulpit for our first special announcement of the evening.
Oh, praise the Lord, everyone. The Lord is worthy greatly to be praised. You know, church, I am thankful to have a church we can go to where we can hear the preaching of the Word of God. I'm thankful for all of our Sunday school classes that teaches us the Word of God. And I am excited today, church, that we can announce that we have a new Sunday school class. And it's a class that aims to answer one single and simple question. Many of us have actually asked ourselves this very question when we first obeyed the gospel. You may recall when you heard the word of God for the first time, you were pricked in your heart. You knew you needed the blood of Jesus. You knew you needed to be baptized in his name. And so you obeyed Acts 2:38. You were baptized, you repented, and you were filled with the Holy Ghost. But then you asked that question, okay, I got the word. I'm saved. I got the blood applied. But then you ask that question, what's next? What do I do now? The answer really is simple. You just take the word of God and you live it. You live the word of God. And church, that's why we need to read it every day. That's why we need to pray it every day. And that's why you need to come to church to hear the man of God preach the word of God. And that's why we decided to call this class the Apostolic Living Class. Simply put, this is a class that facilitates a closer walk with Jesus Christ by putting his word into action. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24, Therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken unto him a wise man which built his house upon a rock. The rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, but it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Now, church, I'm not going to wait for the rain to come before I start living for God. I'm not going to wait for the floods and for the winds to come before I start reading his word and putting it into action. Church, I say we need to be prepared. We're going to build our house on the word of God, our family, our finances, our career, our relationships, hobbies, habits, and our desires. Everything that is within us, let it be based on the word of God. So we encourage whosoever will, come join us in the Apostolic Living Class. Let us live for God. Let us pursue him. Let us take the next step in our journey towards a closer relationship with Jesus, so that when and if those rains, those floods, those winds ever do come, we will be prepared. We will stand, because we stand on the rock that is Jesus Christ. The word of God became flesh and dwelt among us. So I said, let the word become flesh in our lives. So please look forward to the Apostolic Living Class starting September 3rd. And we will be meeting in the gathering room, which is right across from the Cornerstone class. And now please look forward to our First Lady, Sister Kinsey. Can we praise God for a moment while she comes? Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Exciting things are happening at First Pentecostal Church. And our Ladies Power Weekend is coming up. It's presented by the Ladies Ministry on August 25th and 26th for ladies age 12 and up. And the ladies who are going to be ministering at this conference travel all around the nation speaking to women. And some of the topics include self-confidence, divorce recovery, identity issues, stress, and family matters. And even if you have not experienced trauma in your life, and perhaps you've conquered stress and you know how to deal with it, this conference will still inspire you, and it will equip you to help others who maybe are experiencing these problems. And besides that, your registration of $40 includes refreshments after the service on Friday night and a delicious brunch on Saturday catered by Brother Anthony Wilson. If you've experienced his brunch, you'll want to come. Men, you're not allowed. I'm sorry. Women only. I have a limited number of donated tickets, so if you would like to take advantage of that offer, please see me. I'm so thankful for the great things God is doing in our church. Can we give him a hand clap of praise?
Some exciting announcements of things to come. I'm looking forward to what the Lord wants to do in both this new class and in this ladies' weekend. Here's a few reminders for this week. First, Refresh is happening Monday at 7 p.m. That is, of course, online. And then Chosen is happening this Thursday at 7 p.m., also online. So if you have any questions or if you have not had an opportunity to sign up for these sessions, you can see Brother Chris and Sister Amanda Kiesling, and they will be happy to make sure that you are not forgotten for that 7 p.m. call both Monday and Thursday. Some quick reminders. Registration for Purpose Institute is now open online. The semester is going to begin Friday, August the 18th. And of course, if you have any questions about registration or Purpose Institute itself, what does it all mean? What can I do to get involved? You can see Brother Greg and Sister Sharon Stone, and they'll be happy to get you squared away with more information. Golden Eagles Callaway Garden Trip is also upon us. That's happening September 26th through the 28th. Now, there is still time to register, but the deadline to register is September 19th. So if you'd like to attend, make sure that you get that registration in before September 19th. Beginning this week, registration will need to be paid in full. For any questions, you can see Sister Regina Brigham. If I could ask our ushers to please make their way forward as we prepare for this time of giving in our service. Congregation, if I could ask you to please rise as we prepare to give unto the Lord. Remember, you can text to give, you can give online, you can use the app, you can give in the offering plate, and I'm thankful for our ushers as they make their way forward. Now, church, we need to bless this offering. We need to take all of our needs before the Lord. And I'm going to ask you to turn your attention to the prayer board behind me. There are names represented on this board. Every name represents a need. This is a family. This is a situation that is in need of God. And I am asking this congregation to lift their voice in prayer right now and ask the Lord to move in every circumstance. Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you, Lord, that you have called us into this body for such a time as this. But Lord, you see every need, oh God. You knew these needs before they were even presented to you. But Lord, we are going to lift these names now. We're going to speak the name of Jesus over every need, over every circumstance and situation. We are going to release the name of Jesus to heal, to save, and to redeem. We are going to ask you, Lord, to bless this time of worship and bless our giving in Jesus' name.
Show us your glory. to bow here right now, 'cause Jesus, you change everything. Lives healed, my hope is found here right now, 'cause Jesus, you change everything. Chains fall, fear's gotta bow here now, 'cause Jesus, you change everything. Lives healed, my hope found here and now. Now, Jesus, you change everything. Chains fall,
giving praise. Honor him, for he is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And what a great God we serve. What a great God we serve. God bless you. You may be seated. We have some wonderful and exciting things happening at First Pentecostal Church, and I think everybody ought to be excited about what the Lord is doing. We got a new Sunday school class, Apostolic Life and Living, and that helps you to find that next step in order to live out your faith in this evil and dark world. Brother Matthew and Sister Nicole Cunningham are going to be teaching this class, and especially some of you married couples that don't come to Sunday school. You're too cool for school. Well, it's time to come and learn. We are learning, and we have a conference for the ladies here. You need to sign up for that conference. You say, well, I don't need healing. The Lord has touched me, and I've overcome, and that's a wonderful thing. But you can also learn how to minister to people who haven't yet overcome. People say, well, I want to be used in the kingdom. Well, this is a great way for you to learn how to do that. And what better way for us to be participate in something like that than learning how to minister to this dysfunctional world that we're living in? Sign up for it. Let's get excited about small groups. I know you're going back to school and you're sad tonight, but praise God, you have an opportunity to be a witness for Jesus Christ. Get involved in small groups so you can not only learn and connect and have relationship with other people in the church, but you can also reach out to your friends that'll come to something like that won't come to a regular service. So pay attention to those things and consider it and be a part of it. I want all of my intercessors to come up here because I promised Dr. Traylor of the Olive Baptist Church that we would participate tonight, and they're united in prayer. They're meeting at their church tonight with several of the other churches in the area as they pray for our schools. We're going to do our back-to-school prayer next Sunday night, and we'll be doing that next Sunday evening. But tonight, I want us to join with them and their voice. They're really praying for the school board because the essence of what's happening in our school system, and this is more about the public school system, it's really being attacked by all of these forces of wanting to teach curriculum that really has nothing to do with these kids learning. It's to confuse them, it's to further their cultural agenda and their cultural war against the church and against Judeo-Christian values in our world. And that's all it is. And we're praying against all of that. And so I joined with Dr. Traylor, and I told him and promised him that we would do this. So I want everybody to stand. And I want those of you that have a burden for this, I want you to come and stand with our intercessors because we're going to pray together. We're going to pray against these curriculums. We're going to pray against school board members who want to further that curriculum and teach our children the garbage that this world wants to perpetrate upon their impressionable minds and turn them away from truth and from what is right and what is godly. And we want to teach them the right way. We want to give them understanding in the spirit and not expose them to all of the perversion and the horrors that these people are wanting to expose them to. And we'll be praying for our teachers and our students next week. But now we're praying against these curriculums. We're praying and we're joining with Olive Baptist and the rest of the churches that are joining them with Brownsville Assembly, Pace Assembly, Yvonne Horton and Joey Rogers and all of them. We join with them right now in one voice in the wonderful name of Jesus. Father, I pray against these forces of darkness that are encroaching upon our public school systems to teach our children the twisted, terrible, perverted concepts that this culture wants to perpetrate upon our schools. I rebuke it. I take authority over it. God, give us school board members that have some sense, that want to appreciate and value the kingdom purposes of God, that want to walk with Jesus Christ and fulfill. Let us war in the Holy Ghost, church. Somebody lift up their voice against the forces of darkness in our county and these curriculums. We will not have it. We will not put up with it without a fight. We will protect our children and fight on behalf of what is right and biblical and true in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Rabu Yahasianda. Come on, church, I want you to lift up your voice. I want to hear a war cry in this house that heaven will hear us, that hell will know there's a church that still stands for truth. Even in the face of rejection, even in the face of their resistance and their mockery and their put downs, we will stand true on the word of God to the glory of the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. You can make your way back to your seat. Thank you for praying so intensely and powerfully. I appreciate this great church and your prayers. Brother Clint, I want you to come and tell this church what was happening in your CMI class and what you told me in the prayer room.
So, as many of you know, I'm currently attending Embry-Riddle in Daytona Beach, and under pastor's recommendation, I attend Path Apostolic under the leadership of Brother Jody Wells. So, he has mentored me and encouraged me after I felt the burden to start a campus ministry, and we have seen over 4 people get baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost. We've had prayer meetings. We've had a move of God. We have had prayer walks, speaking in tongues in the middle of our student union in the library. And we've had several kids due to COVID in the middle of the pandemic and in other circumstances, whether that be family or financial, that have had to move away from the school. And one of them a couple weeks ago texted me. She was baptized and received the gift of the Holy Ghost through Bible studies at CMI in Daytona Beach.
Yes.
She is now teaching Bible studies, speaking about this truth to her family, and she is now involved in a CMI in Georgia. So praise God.
Woo! Amen. Thank you. You know, it's happening right now, church. It's happening right now. Brother Jeremy Mills was telling me about the fact he was faced with 2 surgeries on his rotator cuffs and his shoulders. He was in a lot of pain, but we had prayer the other night and the Holy Ghost touched him, and that pain is gone, and he's able to work and he's able to do whatever he needs to do. When I called out and I said, there's people here that have tumors in their body, he had a tumor that was going to have to be operated on, and God healed him of that. He went home and it had disappeared. Now, why don't we get excited about that? Huh? What about it, Darren? Come on now. This is exciting stuff. This is just the beginning. I only say that because God's opening the door for it now. And we ought to start expecting it and believing it for every single time we come together as the people of God. I would like to share with you some insights because I believe God wants to deliver us from the slave mentality. He does not want us in bondage to this world. He wants you to be free. And you have to understand that you are a son of God. And you have to know how to operate as a son. God wants to manifest his sons in the earth so he can reveal who his true people are. And I want him to be able to reveal this church to the world as his true people. The only way I know to accomplish is to make this transition from being a slave to a son. Is we have to go to the potter's house. I don't think there's any way we can bypass the potter's wheel. And we got to go there. And I'm going to invite you to go with me as God invited Jeremiah in chapter 18 and verse 2. Arise, go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words. I want God to cause us to hear his word. But I'd rather him use the potter's wheel as a means to transfer his word than through any other means. Because there's safety in the potter's hands. safety there. But if I'm running like Jonah, there's not much safety, not much protection. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. Notice the word behold. He perceived a work was being done on the wheels. How many people do not know the work that God is bringing to pass in their own life through the circumstances and the pressures and the crises that you're feeling pressing upon you, and have no clue that it's the hands of the potter and you're on the potter's wheel? And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again, another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it, perceiving the wheel of God. You may be seated. It is possible to be in the potter's house tonight and not perceive the work that is wrought on the wheels. Do you know how many times I've had people to ask me to pray whatever circumstance is happening in their life, to pray it off of them? I'm going through a crisis and I need you to pray me out of it. And they don't even perceive that what's happening to them is the handiwork of the Almighty God and has nothing to do with the devil. Because they can't perceive the handiwork of God. Jeremiah's attention is drawn to the wheels and the work that is done by the word behold. And he perceived, and it directs him to the wheels, and he perceives the work of God upon the wheels. God was saying to Jeremiah, I'm doing a work. If everybody here could wake up and realize that everything that's been happening in your life is really the work of the Lord, bringing about a difference in your life. Because you're not molded on the mountain peak. You're not molded in the times of affluence and everything going good. You're molded when you're on the potter's wheel and in the potter's hands, as he's taking out the lumps and he's taking out the things that mar the clay and keep it from forming into what he desires it to be. And how many of you know there's things in your life that can keep you from being formed in the image of Christ? And as long as you're blinded to the wheels, you're going to constantly think that you're under attack by the enemy, or it's a random act of fate, or you are a victim of manipulation, or a victim of the system, or a victim of politics. And nothing could be further from the truth. It's a perception of your mind that you think that because somebody else has greater favor, then that's the reason why they are doing what they're doing, and I'm not able to do it because I don't have that favor. And nothing could be further from the truth, because every attempt God's made to mold your life, you've resisted it. Every time God's tried to take that jealousy out of your spirit, that envy out of your spirit, that anger out of your spirit, that offense out of your spirit, you've resisted it and you've put up a barrier and you've asked people to pray and you go from conference to conference and from prophet to prophet wanting to prophesy you off the wheel. But I say you ought to stay there until God finishes the work, until you become the vessel God wants you to be. The Bible says, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. But he's placed under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. I feel this in the Holy Ghost so strongly to tell First Pentecostal Church that the time appointed by the Father is nearing for the First Pentecostal Church, and you need to wake up and realize it. But we got too many babies that don't want to become true sons, and too many people that want to stay immature, and they want to be petted and patted, and they want to be told this and that and encouraged and affirmed, but never a word of encouragement come out of their mouth. But I say to the church, it's time to let God mold encouragement into our spirit, and let him mold submission into our spirit, and let him mold worship into our spirit, not worship that simply responds to a performance, but worship that recognizes I'm in the presence of the King. I walked into the potter's house tonight. I'm in the presence of the one who can shape my life. As long as you're under the governor and the tutors, you're restricted. You can't operate in the authority of your father. You can't access the resources of the company of the family business. You can't spend what you want to spend because you would spend it irresponsibly and you would spend it all. And before you know it, you would have wasted it upon riotous living. But if God puts you back on the wheel, he begins to shape you and he begins to mold you. And all of that desire to do your own will gets out. And the only thing you want to do is his will. Instead of accepting yourself as you are, you decide to let God take it out and let God change you and become the person you're supposed to be. One that speaks faith instead of always speaking that if I just had this and if I just had that and if I knew that and if I knew this and I had this connection and I had that connection, then I would be able to do this and do that. And nothing could be further from the truth. You need to get back on the potter's wheel and let God shape you until you are ready to do something for his cause. I don't understand why I'm going through what I'm going through, and I may not either, but I perceive there's a work being wrought on the potter's wheel. And you need to understand that. As long as you stay in that mental condition of being a victim, you will always believe that everything that God does is manipulative and without purpose. You'll feel like a puppet on a string. You'll feel as a victim of politics, economy, or the weather. But God wants to deliver you from that slave mentality. That's the reason why you come to church, is to learn how to act better. You're a son of God. But God's not going to accept your immorality. God's not going to accept your immature behavior. God's not going to accept your petty jealousies. God's not going to put up with you stirring up trouble on this platform or in the back or in the Sunday school or anywhere else because you feel slighted or you feel like somebody didn't appreciate your work or what you did. God's not going to put up with that kind of junk anymore. We have called forth more demonic spirits by acting so immature and childish than we have done anything else, to where the preacher's got to fight for an hour to get through all the spirits you've called up. I say it's time for us to get our flesh out of the way and quit calling for the demonic spirits to come forth. And we ought to be disciplined by the chastening hand of God until we are submitted, until we want one thing, and that's a move of the Holy Ghost. I don't care whether it's done my way or somebody else's way. If God is glorified and the name of Jesus is praised, I'm not saying this to frighten you. I say this because Jesus loves you and he wants to mold your life into the very vessel that he wants you to be. Because Hebrews 12:6 says, "For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If he endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not?" You have to endure the chastening. I'm not saying it feels good. I'm saying you have to endure it. But first of all, you got to perceive it is. And quit trying to get God to get you out of it when God's got you on the wheel. Have you ever felt like your life is spinning out of control? Like you're on a merry-go-round? I've had people tell me, said, "I feel like I'm on a merry-go-round." And I'm saying, duh. What do you think the potter's wheel is? It spins around. You're on God's merry-go-round. You're on God's wheel. God's molding your life. God's molding your spirit. I guarantee you that everyone here will be used of God according to their gifts and according to their abilities if you'll submit to the potter's hand. You say, but I feel so much pressure on my life. That pressure is the potter's hand trying to mold you and shape you into the person that you need to be. But Brother Kinsey, I resisted and I was proud and I did not do well. And the clay is marred in the hands of the potter, but at least you're still in his hands. Marred clay can still be used because he can make it into another vessel. I said he can make it into another vessel. Don't you give up on yourself just because there's dysfunction in your life and you feel like I can't be used. Get on that wheel and let God mold you until you become more like him. God's not going to stay his hand until he's broken the most prominent, strong feature in your life. The flesh, as we know, is hidden in darkness, and many times we don't see our flesh at work. We think we're a good person, and yet there is such flesh around us, and there is such evil on the inside of us, and we've allowed it to exist, and we haven't recognized it as such. But once the light reveals the flesh and shows us what our true condition is, once enlightenment exposes who we really are and our selfishness and our vainglory and our pride, whatever is revealed in the light is slain by it. God's never revealed anything to you about you that he hasn't already given you the power to conquer. Because I've seen God reveal some things to me about me and about the situation that I was in that said, God, there's no way I can do anything about it. He said, now you've taken your first step toward deliverance because there's never been anything you could do about it. But as soon as God shined the light on it, he gave me power and said, you are delivered. If I show it to you, I've delivered you from it. Now you got to stand up and start walking in the authority of it. Church, I take authority over every sin of immorality. I take authority over everything this world is offering our young people and trying to deceive them and lure them away from truth and righteousness. See, here's how I know whether or not you've really seen the light. How quick do you fall down before him? In every case where God truly revealed himself to people, and that's both Old and New Testament, there was no time between the enlightenment and the fall. God, I am a sinful man. I am nothing but flesh. It's what Simon Peter did when he just witnessed the miracle of the drought of fishes. He said, I'm a sinful man. Depart from me. I don't even need to be in your presence. When God does a true miracle, you don't just jump and shout. You realize that you're a sinful man. You couldn't do that by your own hand. Quit thinking that you're so spiritual that God performs the miracle, or when somebody gets it that you don't think deserves it, let me settle that for you. They didn't. They didn't, and I'll tell you, if God does it for you, you don't either. There ain't none of you. I don't care if I've lived for God all my life, but I don't deserve a thing God's done in my spirit or in my ministry. But I'm so thankful that he has found me worthy, that he has found in me the worth of Jesus Christ, that I'm submitted to him, that he can do something with my life. I'm so thankful for that. If the uncleanness has been exposed, then it cannot remain. It has to go. God did not expose it to you so he could justify you to remain in it. Revelation is the seeing and the slaying. Not just simply seeing it, but killing it. Church, we need to kill sin. We don't need to play with it. We need to kill it. Quit whining over it. Quit sitting around whining because you got caught. Quit sitting around whining because there's something wrong in your life. There's something wrong in everybody's life. But I have received the light. And the light says I can overcome it. And the light says by his hand he can mold it out of my life. Saul of Tarsus was a very capable, self-confident individual, but when the light shined, he reacted by falling on his face. I don't see many Pentecostals doing that. He was inwardly exposed as a religion being a fake, and his attitude being totally contrary to the very nature of God, and yet he falls down as a dead man, not knowing which way to go, and is blinded and could not see. Here's the hardest part of this, is accepting God's sentence and accepting his judgment against our flesh and our own self-will. Because some of you have already stated somewhere in the secret of your heart that if God doesn't do it your way, you're done. God, you got to do this for me, and maybe I'll do that for you. No. No. You hadn't been on the potter's wheel long enough. You used to think that you're so blessed because you're better than other people. And you're ashamed to show your true self, because the reality is you're not a very nice person deep down. Like Job, we fall before the Lord and repent of ourselves, and I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. Surely I'm beyond healing in God. When you get to the point where you realize you can't heal yourself or fix yourself or change yourself, you've just taken your first step towards redemption. You can't fix what's wrong in your flesh, that pride. You can't do it. But this enlightenment, once you come to a place of self-abhorrence, when you realize that in your flesh there is no good thing. I said there is no good thing. When you come to the place in the presence of the Lord that there is not one good thing in me anywhere. And some of you still think you're good. You've served God for 20 years and you think you're good, but then the light shines, you get in a situation and you find out you got a little attitude still. Get a little pressure on you and you feel like you still got a little attitude in you. But I promise you that God will put you on that wheel, and he's not going to let you up until he gets everything out of your life that's not like him, because he doesn't want you to operate in your flesh, because you cannot fulfill the will of God operating in the flesh. Until this outward shell is broken, then the spirit of discipline come upon you to where you don't blame anybody else for anything that's going on in your life. You throw yourself on the mercy of God and you say, God, help me, I am a sinner. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank God for his goodness. Thank God for his blessing. I've had so many people covet the anointing of Brother Stone King, and covet the anointing of Brother Billy Cole, and covet the anointing of other great men, and they have no clue what they're talking about, because I know the price they had to pay for that anointing to operate in their life. And it wasn't fun, and it was horrible. I said it was horrible what they had to go through. But when they fell on their face, and every one of them said the same thing. It was not any exception. Every single one of them told me exactly the same thing. And I'm talking about upwards to 20 to 25 of them told me that when I came to the end of myself and I fell down and I said, God, I am nothing. Whatever you choose to do with my life, that's what I want you to do. That's when it started to turn around and God began to work in my life. What I could not do, God did. Yes. Hallelujah. The psalmist got it right. I was dumb. I opened not my mouth, for thou hast done it. When you realize God's doing it, then you understand. It is God dealing with us, not our brother, not our sister, not the system, not somebody else. God's dealing with us. He's disciplined us, but we didn't recognize his hand. We started blaming other people, so the molding didn't take place, because until you recognize, behold, he wrought a work upon the wheels. As long as I blame somebody on the front row, God can never deal with me. As long as it's my wife's fault, As long as it's somebody else's fault. It is Gary's fault for sure. As long as it's somebody else's fault, God can't deal with me. So when I stop blaming anybody, or here's another one, as long as I have to be right, well, I'm right. When you say that, you've already said it in a self-will that's against God. Because God didn't ask you to be right. He asked you to be submitted. Somebody better hear this preacher. I said somebody better hear this preacher. You got to submit to God's judgment. Hallelujah. Everything is measured in our lives. Everything. He's predetermined the time. The time of the Father is appointed. The boundary, its force, the hard to deal with situation or person that God's put in your life that you can't do nothing with but shoot. Huh? Until you break that spirit, the Holy Ghost can't flow through you freely. Whew. What's God trying to do? He's trying to make you meek and broken. God's method in breaking the outward man will vary. Some of you, it's self-love. You love yourself more than anything in the world. For others, it's pride. For others, it's self-reliance. Others, it's cleverness. It needs to be destroyed. But meekness is the sign of brokenness. And all who are broken produce this meekness. And the more we're broken through God's dealings, the meeker we become. You know, we got too many saints that are just magnificently gifted but not broken. Because if you're trying to operate in the gifts and you're not broken, you're going to destroy everything around you. As soon as you meet them, you sense that undertone in their spirit, that obstinacy. I'm going to do it my way because my way works. Scripture uses different metaphors to describe the Holy Ghost. In one place, it's a fire. In another place, it's water. In another place, it's a hammer. Fire speaks of power, water of cleansing, and a hammer of breaking. But in reference to his character and his nature, he spoke of a dove. He's meek and gentle. The Spirit of God will incorporate his nature little by little like a dove. You say, well, what are the qualities? What am I looking for, Brother Kinsey? Well, James tells you what you're looking for that you don't have. He tells you. James 3, 13 and 18. I'm going to read it because who is a wise man endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. You say, well, you may have wisdom, but is it the meekness of wisdom? I'm talking to Pentecostals tonight. Hear me. Here's how you know you don't have it. He tells you, but if you have bitter envying, strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. That's just a sophisticated, poetic way in the New Testament of saying quit being living in denial. You're denying the truth. You envy, you strife, you're bitter. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual,
devilish. He said it right there. Why are you putting up with that? And then the next time you have a disagreement about whatever ministry you're in strife again and bitter and blaming and envying and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Huh? Calling spirits from everywhere, and I've got to defeat them in this pulpit. How many of you know that we create our own resistance? The devil's always going to resist us, but we got more power than the devil. It's flesh that we got to understand and take authority over. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. You know why there's confusion in your life? It's not because you've got questions. It's because you've got strife and envy in your life. You want something somebody else has. And I found out I don't want anybody else's ministry. I only want the one God wants to give me. I don't want anybody else's anointing. I want the anointing God wants to give me. I love you, and I want you to know, but I'm not trying to be like any other preacher, so don't come up here and say, I wish you preached like that. I don't want to preach like that. I want to preach like God wants me to preach. If you can't understand that, you need to get back on the wheel and let God mold that trash out of your life. I'm not here to preach like anybody else. I'm here to preach like I preach, but I'm here to preach the truth. Here's how I know you got the wisdom from above. It tells you right here in James. It lists it out. First of all, the wisdom that is from above is first pure, peaceable, gentle, and notice this. Here's how you know you got those things. Easy to be entreated. That means if I need to talk to you about something, there's no difficulty. Oh, Brother Kinsey, whatever we need to do, that's what we want to do. Easily entreated. And how many of you, if somebody approaches you, you're mad for 6 months and got to go through therapy the next 6 months? Huh? You don't have the meekness. You're not on the wheel. Easily entreated. Full of mercy. Oh, you want to get whoever's done wrong. They're wrong, and I'm going to get them. No, you're not. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. And I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about him. God said that. I'm just quoting what God said about himself. Listen, I'm not here to get revenge against anybody. I'm here to be a full of mercy, good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. True meekness is approachable, so easy to have contact with, talk to, inquire of. Open to the opinions of others and welcomes instructions. Show me what to do, Brother Kinsey. I want to do it right, and I want to do it to the glory of Jesus. Is anybody approachable? You need to get on the wheel and get to mold in your life so I can approach you, because I got a few of you I want to know. Here's the second thing. You're aware. You're aware of your own fault. You're aware of your environment. You're aware of the spirits that you're inviting into your life when those carnal things get to operating. Such a warmth will not be dull to others' reactions. You'll recognize that I'm in this to minister to people. Everything we do, whether it's serving in the bookstore or whether it's serving in this altar or whether it's serving in the kitchen, we're doing one thing, ministering to people. Whether you're an usher or whether you're a greeter or whether you're in the Sunday school class, all we do is minister to people the word and the blessing of the Lord. You say, well, we're not jumping and shouting tonight. I don't care. This is what you need to mold your life into a person that God wants you to be. And God needs to mold the wine out of your spirit. You need to get the wine out of you because you're always whining about everything. You need to start praising God for what you do have and thank God. Some of the people that are attending our church have been through horrors, and you've been blessed all your life. You ought to shout till Jesus comes over the blessings that God has given you. Here's how I know you got the meekness, is you're unified with the brothers and sisters. You're of one mind and one spirit. You can participate in corporate life. You've got the sense and the desire to receive instruction and correction. You don't care, as long as the flow of the Holy Ghost is in the house, you're excited. And you can smile at me while I'm doing all of this. You say, but I've got an attitude because so-and-so did something in my life. They may have done all of that, but you need to give that up and give up that bitterness and that envy and in that strife, because that produces devilish wisdom. And you need a Holy Ghost wisdom to come on you that says, I am peaceable. I am easily entreated. I am unified with the brethren. There ought to be one mind and one accord. If our brothers from the Baptist can get together and pray over the fact that they're concerned about the curriculum in the school board, Lord, we ought to be able to pray about the same thing. Because that garbage they're trying to sell our young people is wrong. And we need some people that have got a unity of mind and of spirit. But when we walk in here and say, we're going to have a move of God and a crusade, or we're going to do a healing conference, everybody ought to get on board and say, I'm unified. And don't have 15 excuses why you can't do something. Here's another one. Oh, y'all not going to like this one either. Easily edified. Where any word from the Lord blesses you. There's a great advantage, brokenness, because you receive the supply of all. I can put one of our kids up here to preach, and you ought to be able to get just as much to overcome the devil the next day as anybody else that's in this pulpit, from Lee Stone King right on down to the greatest preacher you can think of at the moment. You don't need a great preacher. What you need to do is get on the wheel and let God knock all of that nonsense out of you to where you got a free spirit, where you can be easily edified. How many times have we come to meetings unbroken, untouched? How many brothers have come because their intellect is keen and they're smart as a whip, and they sit down and they listen to somebody with broken English try to preach the truth, and they turn them off and they can't receive anything because their mind is sharper than the mind of the one that's presenting the word of God. He'll analyze the thoughts of the preacher and reject it as useless and meaningless. Months and years will pass by till God breaks him with a crisis or a circumstance to where he realizes, I need God no matter what. I don't care who comes. I need a word from the Lord. And then all of a sudden they realize it's not my intellect that's going to change me. It's the spirit of the Lord. And they touch the spirit of the preacher, and they find out it's not in the presentation, and it's not in the pronunciation, and it's not in the eloquence, and it's not in the capability of the minister, but it's in the condition of my heart. This may not be your favorite kind of preaching, but it's time for us to speak the truth in love. Why? So we can grow up in all things in him, which is the head, even Christ. But till you learn how to talk in love, you can't grow. He didn't say hear it in love. It said speak it in love. I wish somebody would get up and shout on this message, because this is good stuff. This will change your life. I said this will straighten you out. This will put you on the narrow way. This is the best kind of preaching. If we can get this spirit, we can take on every devil in hell. You can stay standing. I remember so many years ago I was praying. And I said, God, why are you doing this to me? I don't understand. Do something. Bump somebody off. I was like that brother whenever they just built his brand new building. I believe it was in Cleveland, Ohio. Brand new church, seat 1,100, 1,200 people. During the riots, they burned it to the ground. And he was walking up that hill to where that church was, burned absolutely to the ground. Brand new, just built it, finished it. Had maybe one or two services in it. He said, God, if you'll find the man that did this, I won't kill him, Lord, but I'll shoot him in the leg. Have you ever wanted to shoot somebody in the leg? And then he wrote that beautiful song, I got a long way to go to be like Jesus. And the Lord said, if I shoot anybody, I'll have to shoot myself. Because nobody's doing this to you. I am. I am. You, I'm a good guy. I'm cool, Jesus. He said, you're not broken enough. You're not ready for me to do what I want to do. If you'll submit to my hand, I'll shape you into the person I want you to be. But this is from me. And I'm talking to somebody right now in the Holy Ghost. Some of you hadn't listened to a single thing I said because you've already got, oh yeah, so-and-so needs that. And if you've done that, you're the one who needs it. Oh, yeah, man, I'm glad. Boy, I hope they're hearing him. No, I hope you're hearing me. Because this is really about all of us. I shouldn't even have to give an altar call tonight. Somebody ought to just want to come pray and say, God, I want to get back on the wheel until you mold me. I know what you're doing in my life now. I've been enlightened. I see it, and I know there's things that have to be. God will reveal things about you that will blow your mind. And only he can deal with it, because you can't fix yourself. If you could, you could change yourself. You'd be your own savior. That's why I need a savior. I need a God talking to me. Ha-la-la-la-bo. And I'm just going to let you pray. Come on, church. I just want you to pray. This is about you and God, not me and you or anything else. You need to pray. God, hear my voice here tonight. Mold me and shape me into the person you want me to be. Ha-la-la-li-ya-ra-da-bo. When you perceive the will of God and you see with the work that is wrought, and know that we're not ready for what God wants to do with our flesh in control. And I've listed it all out. It's in James, listed perfectly, exactly what it is and what it ain't. But until that's worked into me, I still need to be on his wheel. Hallelujah. Oh, I worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God's doing a work in us. Go ahead and let him do it. Let him take out that envy, that strife.
at wanting everything to be your way. Lay it on the altar. Let God mold it and shape it. Hallelujah.